So awesome to be here in person, if I don't kill myself on the scooter. Thank you for being here. Welcome. We are going to put on a show that everyone is going to remember for the rest of their careers, because this is the first real live in-person event that all of us have been to since COVID. Woo! Yes. And it feels absolutely amazing to be on a real stage with real people in the flesh. I don't know about you, but I've been stuck behind a camera, and I'm a mover. I like to walk. And this is a problem, because I've been stuck in the same place for the entire pandemic. Today, we have an amazing lineup of speakers. And what's really special about today, when we're talking about machine learning and data, is that we're focused on applications, right? We're going to talk about applied machine learning, how this technology is changing all industries. I'm Zach Shelby, co-founder and CEO of Edge Impulse. I'm going to talk about the business side, the applications, what people are deploying in the field, some exciting partner announcements. And then I'm going to be joined in a moment by Dan, our lead founding ML engineer. He's going to dive into the technology behind all this. How does it work? And some exciting new stuff that we're just about to release. Now, I came on a scooter today, not just by accident. I came in because, actually, light electric vehicles are an important part of solving a lot of our urban mobility problems. And this electric vehicle actually runs machine learning. So we're going to talk about how we're solving problems with machine learning on these types of vehicles in a moment. There's also a reason why we're here at the Computer History Museum. I don't know about you, I got started on a Commodore 64 in the very beginning of my career as an engineer, aged 8. I was given this magical thing, right, that let me create and solve problems directly in code. And I just thought that was such a game-changing way of building things that it pulled me completely into this industry. And for those of you that come from the European side, you probably worked with the BBC Micro about the same time. So how many of you got started in this Commodore 64 BBC Micro days? All right, a few of us oldsters are still around. But what's important about the Computer History Museum is that all that heritage of compute is here, and what we do in embedded is the closest we get to that feeling of writing BASIC on a Commodore 64, right? We're still down there building hardware, bare metal, right? Implementing features that run this world in what I call the invisible compute. So I think this is the perfect place to hold this event and have all of you talk about the cool things that we're building with machine learning. Now, I was recently in Helsinki over the summer, and we all talk about the AI singularity. I think I actually saw the singularity. I happened to go through a park on a Saturday night, walking home, and I found about 5,000 teenagers, and 5,000 of these all at the same time in this park. And it was a massive mess, right, of these things driving on grass, doing wheelies, 360s, skids. I was like, holy cow, I didn't know you could do that with these. That's awesome, but that's not great in a city environment. So we've recently partnered with Particle, awesome company here in the Bay Area that's super well known for enabling IoT and cellular IoT. We partnered with them to use machine learning to solve some of these problems. So this is an actual particle tracker one here attached to this. Usually this is embedded in the device. And what we've been able to do already is detect the riding surfaces that the rider is on. Are you on gravel? Are you on grass? You know, are you within what the city allows? Are you a drunk driver? Super important question to be solved, right? There's a lot of accidents that happen on vehicles like this. Are you wearing a helmet? We can use low-power computer vision to say whether the rider has a helmet or not. Problems like this can be solved with machine learning right on the device, right, and have a big impact on vehicles and mobility. But this market's much bigger, right? We talk about something like this. This is asset tracking. And we can embed this type of machine learning technology in anything that's low-power, mobile, a tag, shipping pallets, for example. We're going to hear from Brambles later today in our industry panel. You're going to want to check that out. Brambles is one of the world's largest logistics companies, managing over 700 million shipping pallets all around the world. And they're looking at intelligence in those pallets, and what does that mean for them using machine learning? So we're going to hear from Brambles. Asset tracking as a market, $35 billion now, as an asset tracking market. It's a lot we can do with machine learning. When we talk about machine learning, though, we talk about something really special at Edge Impulse. We have a vision that I think is really unique, and that's what we're talking about today. And that's data-driven engineering. And the way to understand what data-driven engineering is that up till now, we've really programmed everything with rules, right? Us as human programmers, our job is rulemaking. Here's Jan, my co-founder and CTO. So Jan unfortunately couldn't travel here because of the EU travel restrictions. He tried. So instead, we gift him. He'll go down in history as this gift, right? This will be his most famous moment. We gift Jan, and Jan's a super talented programmer, right? He can program anything. But there's limits to what we can program in rules, right? When we start getting into super complex patterns, right? Computer vision, image sequences, audio of dolphins under the water, that's stuff that we can't capture with code, right? So this process of trial and error, right, to solve problems has limitations. What's happening now with machine learning is actually not about AI or machine learning at all. What's really exciting is that we're entering a new age of data-driven engineering, where instead of just having Jans solve the problem by trial and error, we can collect real industry-specific, very, very well understood data from machines in the field with your customers, right, in your products. And we use those data sets to drive the engineering of the algorithms to solve the problem. And so you could think of machine learning as a data-driven engineering algorithm automation tool lets you use large amounts of data to solve very complex problems that us humans could never write rules for. And then we test those algorithms with more data. Again, that's a really solid way of testing, massive amounts of data for testing. And what happens when you want to go improve a machine learning algorithm? You don't go and write more code, no. You collect more data. So this becomes a very data-intensive cycle of get data sets, generate algorithms, deploy a feature, go improve it by getting more data. And this is something all of us need to learn. I think that over the next 10 years, this will be something that all engineers use across all industries. And we're just seeing the beginning of that with edge compute. This is where it starts. And we think this will change everything across all industries. It's starting with edge compute and embedded. And the reason is that we have some really strong factors that are pushing the compute towards the edge. And there's three important things. Power, right? Being able to do this right where the data is created and not having to turn on a radio and send it to the cloud, that's one. Bandwidth, things like LPWAN, right? Hugely limit the amount of information we can send to the cloud. So if we can compress that data right on the edge, huge benefits to that. And finally, cost. If we have to move all this data in huge pipes to the cloud, we're going to run into real problems, right? In cloud costs, in storage costs. It's not an unlimited resource as we used to think. So these three factors are moving all of this compute more and more towards the edge. This is changing industrial applications. I'll talk about that today. It's changing logistics and asset tracking, which I already mentioned. And it's changing human sensing, wearables, health, and everything else that you can imagine. Our mission at Edge Impulse is really simple. We think that in order to solve all these problems, we can't do it alone. We need an ecosystem. And we need developers and engineers who are out there solving these problems today, right? The domain experts, the embedded developers, the system engineers, the chemical engineers. We need them to be able to solve problems with data, not only data scientists and ML experts. And so we're all about democratization. That's why we exist. We're helping democratize this technology for the experts so that they can solve problems, they can generate value from data. But I also believe that in the next decade, this will change how we do all engineering. So we're going to someday see jet engines designed with data like this. We're going to see aircraft and bridges. All forms of bioengineering will be data-driven. This will go everywhere. It will change everything. Eventually, it will even change the cloud. That might not be us. It might be you. But this is that big of a trend that we see, that we really want everybody to be educated on how to take advantage of it. And to do this, right, at this kind of scale across all these industries, Edge Impulse is not going to do this alone, right? We're going to do this as a part of an entire industry. That's how big the problem is. And we're started by building a really important ecosystem. Already, as of today, just over 18 months since launching our platform, we're at 20,000 developers on the platform. and growing very quickly. And those 20,000 developers are building amazing projects already. We're going to talk about some of those. But we're also growing very quickly. So we estimate already by the end of 2022, we'll be at 100,000 developers on the platform developing these ML algorithms. And why do we know that? Because we know the size of the developer base. We've worked with Slash Data to look at how fast developer bases are growing. We already see that by 2025, there'll be over 3 million IoT developers using machine learning day-to-day in their job. That's what the data shows. So we're going from 100,000 to millions of developers. That's a huge opportunity. But this isn't just about developers, right? This is about real applications. Already this year, as of now, we've had 40,000 ML projects developed on Edge Impulse, creating amazing things, right, from all industries in deployment, right? We're free for deployment as a default sign-up. So we have people deploying things in the wild every day. And in our community, already we have 10,000 enterprises that we're tracking that are following the newsletters, signing up for webinars, using the platform day in and day out. And that's a huge customer base that we can all take care of. This takes ecosystem in order to succeed in this. I'm going to come back to ecosystem and tell you what's happening with the hardware and the silicon to make this happen. But first, I want to talk about some of the amazing projects that we're seeing from the community. So I've just chosen three really cool projects that community members have built. This one's created by Sheena, one of our own team members, looking at early blindness and problems with diabetic sight using really cheap computer vision and data sets. So think about cheap cameras you can put in the field in a developing country, take a picture of someone's eye, and immediately tell whether they're having problems with early blindness or diabetes. That's a huge win, right? We've already demonstrated that this is possible on cheap hardware. In agriculture, we have Adam, one of our community members, who's built a cheap embedded Sony camera with a multi-core MCU processor into agricultural robots, driving robots on an MCU using machine learning. That's amazing. Today, we need an NVIDIA Jetson oftentimes to run a robot in agriculture. Huge improvements. And we've been working with Blues Wireless. Soon, we'll have Ray Ozzie up on stage, former CTO of Microsoft. He's going to be with me talking about what Blues Wireless is doing in this space. And they recently released a very cool project just doing remote monitoring on old gauges, right? Analog gauges, training machine learning with very cheap computer vision to tell what's happening with these gauges. There's millions and millions of these out there. Really easy problem to solve. Send it over cellular, job's done. Just a touch in the ocean of all these projects that people are building, and really, day in and day out, it amazes us. Hardest part, our job of creating this keynote and this event was choosing from all these projects what we should talk about. And to make this happen, right, these are systems problems. All of these engineerings that we're talking about, all the industries that we're solving, this isn't just a low-end MCU, deeply embedded, or a high-end Linux. We actually need to solve the entire problem across hardware from MCUs all the way up to CPUs, GPUs, right? That's how we think about this space. Our job is to make sure that machine learning runs on all of this. Just as easy to deploy this on a Raspberry Pi as it is on a Cortex M0. What's happening, though, is to do this, we've built a very large ecosystem of hardware partners. Soon we're going to hear from ARM. Steve Roddy will be here talking about the ARM roadmap in acceleration for NPUs on the ARM architecture. We're going to hear from all of our silicon partners over the next 2 days in workshops, teaching people how to use the technology in the field. And we're going to hear some really exciting announcements for what we're doing with Edge Impulse to enable new deployments on new types of hardware. So we can't do this alone. We have to work across the whole hardware industry to make this happen. And our job is to make this easy. That's why we talk about user experience. If we can't get this done in 5 minutes, from data collection to training a model to deploying it on hardware, then we have to improve, right? 5 minutes is the rule that we have to make the user experience work. Now, this is Zach's cheat sheet. You're going to see me use this for years to come, how I think about the silicon industry and what's happening. And I think it's really important that we have a picture in our mind what kind of workloads work on hardware today. And so I created this to kind of show us where we're at, state of the art, with software optimizations for TinyML on today's brownfield hardware, right? No fancy accelerators, just stuff that you can buy off the shelf today. We can do sensor applications down to really low-end Cortex M0 parts. Audio is already possible on M4s. We can do image classification now on M7s, like that retinal scan application. And we can do video on a little bit higher power GPU class devices like an NVIDIA Jetson. Right? That's the state of the art today. This is what we deploy day in and day out. But this is changing all the time. The way you can think about this is that as accelerators enter the market, the accelerators are going to move these workloads to the left. Right? We're going to get better workloads deeper into the silicon, and we're going to be able to do that at lower power. So this is a super exciting time in the industry. And we have a couple really cool announcements today that we're going to be talking about. One is that we're not just sticking to the low-end MCUs. You noticed early this year we already went into Raspberry Pis, working with NVIDIA to go on higher power devices. Well, we're now starting to do the same with Intel. So with Intel, we've now released support for all x86 fully accelerated targets running Linux. So you can now just go use Edge Impulse for Linux, deploy on any Intel machine. And that's important, not because of your PC, but because x86 industrial PCs are everywhere in industrial applications. So we'll talk more about that in a second. And today we made a press release with the Synaptics team, recently announced acquisition of DSP Group, for their new Katana AI chip. And this SoC and AI platform is really interesting because it brings multi-core MCU together with neural network acceleration in one package, plus Wi-Fi and Bluetooth built in. And that's really game-changing because it gets us right in the middle of this range of applications. It gets us hardware that's accelerated but low power, so we can do things like sensors, yes, audio applications, absolutely, but also more complex computer vision applications right at low power points. So we think this is going to be a super exciting piece of silicon, and we'll be announcing support on Edge Impulse soon. Now, I'll come back to silicon in a second, but first I wanted to give you guys an overview of what's happening for the rest of the day at Imagine. We're not going to talk much at Edge Impulse. We're just here to host all of you to talk about applications. Dan's going to join me soon and talk about technology, and we're going to follow that up with the keynote from Steve Roddy from ARM. We're going to talk about the future of acceleration and where that's going, and then we're going to dive deep into the health industry. So Z has joined us from Aura Ring, the amazing Ring guys that can track your health. Many of us use this. I'm going to be very disappointed if Jennifer Aniston doesn't come on stage with you but I understand if she couldn't make it. We're going to have Ray Ozzie here joining us by video with me on stage. We're going to talk about what's happening with Blues Wireless and cellular and his journey from Lotus Notes all the way to what he's doing with us today with machine learning. We're going to have a coffee break, some networking for us here in Mountain View, and a break for everyone watching our live stream all around the world. And then we're going to have some awesome guests from Google talk about what we can do with machine learning technology so that it's fair for everyone, right? How do we build machine learning models that really work in the field as we expect them to? That's going to be an important talk. We're going to have a special guest from IRNOS join us on stage to talk about not only a power smart grid application that we've deployed recently, but how we're working on nature conservation applications together. We're going to have a second coffee break, followed by Zach Supala from Particle, who's going to tell us more about this really cool tech they're working on with asset tracking. And then we're going to join us with Microsoft. Pete Bernard joined me on stage to talk about 5G and IoT. And then finally, Sarah Mastin, one of our most important applications that we care about is nature conservation, right? Using this technology for good. She's going to be telling us about Project 15 at Microsoft and what we're doing with elephant conservation with this technology. So that's going to be one of the most important talks of the day. Make sure you hit that. We're going to have a lunch break for all of us, including our virtual attendees, followed by our industry panel. So that's going to be exciting. We're going to go in with the biggest industry players, talk about what is the future of applications, what's the impact of embedded in ML. So please, everybody will join us for this for today, and I'll tell more about this afternoon's activities as well. But now the really exciting stuff. We now have our first mass market consumer machine learning device on the market. And I'm just gonna to pick this up for you here. This is the first machine learning powered coffee maker. And we love coffee makers, right? That's where all IoT applications have started. But this coffee maker is really cool because by Keurig, right? Keurig has these little cups that you can put in coffee makers. There's hundreds of them. So what this technology does is when you insert a pod, over 900 different pods in this coffee maker, it automatically detects what kind of pod is being inserted. I won't tell you how. Automatically detects it and can set all the brewing properly across these 900 different brewing pods. I think that's just absolutely amazing. And a consumer device released this summer. You can buy it yourself. We just bought one online. And after this, we're going to put this out at the coffee station. You can make your own coffee here and try to figure out how this works with machine learning. So we're starting to see this happen in this industry, right, where consumer electronics are embedding machine learning in the products themselves. This technology and this low-power operation of TinyML is also helping us enable a whole wave of ultra-low power and ultra-smart wearables. Not just wearables that you wear on your wrist, but things you put on your head, headsets, things like voice detection, keyword spotting, but also new types of interaction modes. We see people doing things like radars that can detect kind of hand motions without you having to touch your headset or say something. I don't like saying things with keywords, for example. I feel like I'm talking to myself. I'd much rather use my hands. And we're seeing this with new technologies in noise cancellation using not only signal processing but also machine learning. And this is just going to grow. This is a 400 million unit market just in 2020 alone. Lots of applications for embedded machine learning here. But I get not so excited by the consumer devices. I get even more excited by the health devices. And this is where I think what Aura's doing with using, you know, non-intrusive, non-buzzing, this doesn't make a sound, it doesn't make a vibration. It just measures your health, right? Measures how you're sleeping. How ready are you for tomorrow's activities? Are you healthy enough to exercise? This has been a game changer for my own health. That's how I balance being a busy CEO with a family, right, and my own health. This is game changing. But this is also powered by data. So we're really lucky to have Aura here giving a keynote, talking about what they're doing with data, how they use data-driven engineering to innovate. So make sure to check out this talk by Z in a little while. But even more interesting is when we get into safety and saving people's lives. Earlier this year, you might have noticed we announced a really cool application around the smart grid. So managing smart grid monitoring and trying to prevent the cause of forest fires here in California. Many of them are caused by power lines that fail, lightning strikes, branches hitting lines. So we tried to solve the problem at the source, but we still have firefighters that go out day in and day out and risk their lives to help protect our communities. And we need to be doing something to help protect their lives. So just recently, we partnered with FireHud, amazing startup that creates this little tracking device for firefighters, people in industry, right, first responders, to not only tell where they are, but tell how they're doing. And we've successfully applied machine learning on their data sets to detect not just how someone's doing right now, but what will their core body temperature be in 5 minutes. And that's super important in firefighting. In the last 18 months alone at Cal Fire, over 150 firefighters have come down with heat exhaustion-related sicknesses. Five firefighters have died in the last couple decades from these kind of heat-related incidents. That could be prevented by this. So we're going to hear a short video from FireHud talking about this.
The problem FireHud is trying to solve is overexertion injuries. The smart PPE industry is headed towards smarter sensors, smarter metrics. For instance, today, FireHud and other gas sensor detecting companies just simply measure heart rate or detect certain gases in the air. But in the future, FireHud, for instance, will be able to measure things like exertion or exhaustion, where really we aggregate a whole bunch of sensor data into more usable metrics for something like incident commanders to use. This collaboration with Edge Impulse is important for us, so that way you can provide first responders, military members, or industrial workers the ability not just to see what someone's core temperature is at a given instant, but what it could become in 5 to 10 minutes. Then whoever's in charge of safety there would receive an alert. The firefighter himself could receive an alert.
great example of where this technology is going. Because of low power and sensing and embedded all-in-one, we can also save lives as well as improving people's health. Now, another exciting announcement, this scoreboard of mine is going to change. Today, we've announced a new partnership with Sintient, who has released some really amazing silicon technology in that it changes this game completely, in that it's not just a low-end MCU. It's an ultra-low-power neural processing unit that can run not at tens of milliwatts or hundreds of milliwatts, but it can run at hundreds of microwatts running machine learning models all the time. And so to talk about this new announcement and this really cool new part, I want to invite Kurt Busch, CEO, founder of Sintient, up on stage with me.
Thank you, Zach.
Thanks for joining me, Kurt. Now, this is a super exciting device. This is not just an NDP neural processing unit. This is an entire TinyML board that runs Arduino. Tell us a little bit about this and your vision for TinyML.
Sure. So when we started Sintient, our idea was that if you looked in the data center, you had CPUs and you had GPUs. And if you go to the edge, you really didn't have the equivalent of a GPU. So we started Sintient to build effectively the neural processor for the edge. And we started off and we really engaged with a lot of tier one accounts. We shipped millions of units. But we saw that the power of machine learning is not just playing with the huge companies, but getting it out to everyone. And we wanted to democratize machine learning. And then when we met Edge Impulse, I don't know, 10 months ago or so, we had this idea that said, let's kick off a TinyML board to be able to put high-powered machine learning into anyone's hands. And you know, if we look at it, you need a lot of things, right? You need silicon, you need data, you need training. And if it wasn't for the work that Edge Impulse is doing, we really couldn't put this into everybody's hands.
And what's amazing here is that we can run this at super low power. So what does that mean for applications? Is this an always-on world now?
Yeah, always on. Well, let's look at what machine learning really can do for us. You know, you talked about the Commodore 64. And, you know, what was our interface to the Commodore 64? It was the keyboard. And then along came the mouse, and that was our interface to Windows. And then we have the touchscreen, and that's our interface to the smartphone. And at each step, the volumes went up by about 3x. We went from about 150 million units a year, 500 to 1.5 billion. Machine learning is really what powers this interface between the real world and the digital world. Mm. And to do that, it needs to be always on. We need to be always on collecting and interpreting data in tiny devices, such as is your ring there, the Aura ring, which I'm gonna go get one right after this meeting. That looks super cool. You should be giving them out, but maybe not. Or wearables. I mean, if you can do anything in the cloud today. There's tons of processing power, it's cheap and whatnot, but that ring can't go to the cloud with every time it needs to process. My watch can't go to the cloud every time it needs to process. We need to put the processing into the device. We need to collect the data, always collecting the data, and be able to do that kind of high-powered processing to see very useful outcomes, whether it's health, whether it's some kind of an alert, whether it's just an interface, bridging from the real world to the digital world.
And you made another announcement just recently with the NDP 200. And if I understand right, this is now bringing computer vision capable neural networks to under a milliwatt?
Yes, so the NDP 200, we're really excited about that. We just announced that. It uses the same Sintient Core 2 architecture as the NDP 120. And we see these devices as I'm gonna show my age a little bit here. If you guys remember when Intel came out with the 386, it was really what changed compute. It was the 386 that could run multiple processing, could run multiple things at the same time, and Windows started taking off. We see the Sintient Core 2 devices, the NDP 120 and the NDP 200, as effectively our 386s. These things run lots and lots of different neural networks. So the NDP 200, not only does it do audio and sensor, but it also can do image. And we do that at under a milliwatt. So Zach, you need to update your chart and You know, for everyone's benefit, the NDP200 delivers the type of performance that you would expect out of a high-end MCU, like an A53, at under 1 milliwatt type power in running neural networks. So we think that now, if we look at the senses that we can bridge between the real world and the digital world, we can do sensors, vibration, we can do audio, we can do speech, and now we can do vision.
Absolutely amazing. My chart's going out the window. I'm coming out with a new chart soon. Kurt, thank you very much for joining me and helping with the announcement.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Proud to be here.
And finally, I want to talk about industrial. I think industrial is the behemoth in the room in this market, right? This is such a massive market, and there's so many applications that we've seen being worked on that we didn't even try to list them now. Instead, we invited the experts here to talk about them themselves. So today at our industry panels, you're going to hear from GE, Flextronics, Schlumberger, Siemens, Tata Steel, Brambles I already mentioned. So we're going to hear from the experts themselves on what they see happening with machine learning and industrial. But we think this is one of the biggest markets there is in ML and will change these industries forever. We've also been building a really close partnership with Microsoft to give all the integrations with the services you need to build full systems. Things like making Edge Impulse work with Azure IoT, making it work with Azure Edge. These are projects that we've launched recently. And we've recently joined Microsoft for Startups to make this even easier for people to integrate with their industrial systems. That's something to watch out for. We're going to hear from Pete Bernard soon on stage about what they're doing with IoT, 5G, and computer vision and ML. But we have one more thing. A few really important announcements for customers in these spaces. We take security really seriously with what we do in industrial, right? We're dealing with data that is sensitive. We're sometimes dealing with healthcare information from people. So security is important. This fall, we'll be finishing our SOC 2 certification for Edge Impulse for enterprise customers. So we'll be able to do SOC 2 certified solutions. And we also realize that it's not always the OEM that has the data we need to work with, right? It's sometimes your customer that needs to be able to work with data. And so to make it easier to provide machine learning, we're also announcing white label support. So we're able to integrate Edge Impulse with branding, with single sign-on, with integration for data collection and deployment for any of our partners. So that means you can get Edge Impulse built into what you're doing towards your customer base and make it part of your own solution. So that's an exciting new development. And to support that in larger and larger customer deployments, we're beginning to do this as private cloud. You know us as public cloud, you use us with login. We're starting to deploy in cloud infrastructure in the accounts of our industrial customers as private cloud in the near future. So something to talk about with our team if that's interesting for you. And finally, to go after this industrial market, we can't think of a better partner than Advantech, one of the world's leading industrial PC manufacturers, industrial control hardware manufacturers. Together, we're going to be deploying Edge Impulse support for the millions of devices that they ship every year and enabling not just machine learning development for industrial, but the whole lifecycle management, all the way down to deployment of these devices together. We have a short video from Eric Cao of Advantech.
Hi, Zach, and Imagine attendees. I'm Eric Cao, managing the new Edge Software Business Unit in Advantech. Advantech has been known for the global leader of industrial solutions with 2 billion run rate. It has aggressively expanded to the AI, IoT, and cloud ecosystems in the recent years. We have evaluated many AI/ML platforms and solutions. Edge Impulse stands out with its mission to empower industrial builders, not data scientists, to develop and deploy machine learning models on their own in all kinds of verticals on a wide spectrum of edge devices, which is exactly what Advantech wants to deliver to its global customer base in the very near future. We are moving full speed to integrate Advantech hardware and software solutions such as Wise DeviceOn with Edge Impulse SaaS platform as we speak. We will launch the joint platform early next year with the only goal to wow the industrial world. It is totally my pleasure to be part of this Imagine event, showing Advantech's full commitment behind Edge Impulse. It's going to be a win-win strategic partnership to to deliver exciting stuff. Back to you, Zach.
Thanks, Eric. Eric's in Taiwan. He couldn't make it. He wanted to be here really badly, but he was gracious enough to give us a video to show. Last thing I'm going to leave you with, right? This is about your data from your industry, from what your specialists are working on. That's where the value is in ML. So the thing you need to take away from all the stuff we're talking about, Imagine, is start collecting your data. Start making value and use of it. This is the time to begin. And I'm going to pass it over to Dan to dive into the technology.
Hey, everybody. So it's so awesome to be here in person, standing in front of real human beings. You know, it's an amazing feeling. And my name's Daniel Situnayake, and I lead the ML team at Edge Impulse. And I want to talk to you today about, you know, some of the technology we're working on and some of the stuff that we have planned. The big theme of our talk today is around data-driven engineering, and I think that's at the heart of what we do at Edge Impulse, so I'm going to focus on that a lot. But a little bit of intro, you know, a few years back, I was working over the road from here at the Google campus, and that was where I was lucky enough to meet Pete Warden, who introduced me to the idea of embedded AI. And actually, I was really lucky because I got to write a book together with Pete that's kind of an introduction to embedded AI. And the thing is, it turned out to be a really thick book. And that kind of says a lot about the learning curve for this stuff a few years back. I think it's quite challenging for people to get started working with embedded AI. And what I'm absolutely thrilled about is that Edge Impulse has really flattened that learning curve out so that pretty much anyone can come along and start building their own models. And a core part of that, I think something that we understand really well about this space, is the idea of the feedback loop. And that the goal in all of this work is to tighten and shorten the feedback loop between collecting data, training a model, testing it in the lab, and testing it in the real world. And the tighter and smaller that feedback loop gets, the easier it is to be successful in building edge AI applications. But that feedback loop, it all starts with data. And it starts with real data, messy data, the kind of glorious haystack of information that every organization has. You know, this is spread across dozens of different places, scattered from the cloud through to data lakes, down to rusty old hard drives in your desk drawer. And a hugely important part of this whole process is pulling in that data and making it usable for training models. So we've built some amazing tools for that. To begin with, we have a load of tools that can connect to your cloud or your data lake or to your developer machine and pull data in. We then have tools even that you can give to your partners to allow them to securely upload data via portals and bring it into your system so that you can get all of the information you need under one roof in a way that's queryable. Once you've got that data into your system, it needs combining and it needs cleaning so that you can train machine learning models based on that. And often we're talking about things like hundreds of terabytes of raw sensor data that needs to be dealt with before it can be used in training. So we can do things like spin up hundreds or thousands of parallel cloud jobs that will automatically process your data and get it into the form that it needs to be. And then we provide tools for quality control and reporting that allow you to understand that that pipeline is working as expected. And then finally, we close the loop. So once you've trained and evaluated a model, you can integrate that model and its deployment with your own CI/CD pipeline. So you can use custom blocks within Edge Impulse to build a firmware, deploy it to a device in your CI/CD, and test it all. So you have this full loop of bringing data in, training models, and testing it on real-world devices. So the really exciting thing, all of these features have been available for enterprise customers and are available right now, but we're opening them up for all developers in the first quarter of next year. I'm super excited about that because it means we unblock so many potential projects people are going to be able to build once they can start bringing together all of their organizational data into one place. And There's going to be a really amazing talk next up from Aura about how they've been able to use these tools in developing their own next generation algorithms. So data is obviously incredibly precious, and a really important thing is making sure that you get the most value out of that data that you possibly can. And Eon Tuner is one of our tools that help you do just that. So it's based around this fundamental idea that you shouldn't just think about an ML model in isolation, but actually in embedded, the whole pipeline of signal processing and machine learning are just as important. And finding the right balance between those two things is key to extracting all of the usable signal from your data and not leaving anything on the table. So the Eon Tuner basically provides a way that you can upload a data set and with a single click explore the space of all the combinations of signal processing and machine learning model that will let you understand what's going on in that data and build actionable insights. And the core thing, the key thing is that you can actually provide specifications around device constraints. So if you only have 50 milliseconds to work with in your budget, or if you only have 50 kilobytes of RAM available, you can tell Eon Tuner about that, along with the device you're targeting, and it will automatically find the best balance of signal processing and machine learning to fit within that budget. So we've released Eon Tuner with support for audio originally, and today I'm excited to announce that we have support for motion and vision available. So you can log into Edge Impulse today and start using Eon Tuner with vision projects. And we also have an API coming later this year that will expand the flexibility even further. So we really, really care about devices and the diversity of devices that are out there for embedded ML. And Eon Tuner also helps you do more with less hardware, which helps you make the most of limited compute and heterogeneous compute, where maybe you have different types of compute present in a single device. So for example, if you have an accelerator on device that speeds up how quickly a deep learning model can run, then maybe that gives us more budget to spend on signal processing. And Eon Tuner will automatically figure that out and find the right balance within that space for your project. We also make it really easy to target brownfield devices. So maybe if you have devices out there in the field that have some budget in their duty cycle, you can tell Eon Tuner how much latency budget you have, maybe, and it will generate models that fit within that. But I think very strongly that the most important thing in any machine learning project is understanding how it works in the real world. This is by far the most critical thing. And that's why we're taking a good look at how the tooling around this works. So the typical way of understanding a model's performance is checking its performance against a held-back test data set. And while this gives some understanding of how it works in ideal conditions in the lab, it doesn't really tell you what's going to happen when you put this thing into the real world and start dealing with streams of messy data. So that's why we've built a whole set of new features that are coming up soon around application testing at scale. So this means you can do things like testing your impulse on a realistic sample of data. For example, 24 hours of audio captured from the place that your device is going to be deployed. If you don't have that data, we can even synthesize realistic samples using the examples that are in your test data set already. And our tooling will allow you to measure and visualize all the industry standard metrics like false accept rate and false reject rate, which tell you how your application is going to perform on real world streaming data. So you can see in our UI here, we basically allow you to understand which examples your model is failing to classify correctly, so you can understand and dig in and make improvements. This is, again, another way to close that feedback loop. And the really cool thing is this allows us to start to explore the impact of post-processing on your model. So the algorithms that you apply to understand and interpret the output of the machine learning model you're using. And that's incredibly exciting because we've now been able to use a genetic algorithm to design the optimal post-processing configurations for your particular application. So you give us your data set, we train an impulse using Eon Tuner, And then we can design this optimal Pareto frontier of potential trade-offs between false accepts and false rejects, for example, or any other metric that you choose. And as the domain expert, as the application engineer, you make the final call about which one of those trade-offs fits your application the best. So we're doing all the hard work for you and then letting you choose the exact optimal result for your application. This even accounts for device constraints and latency. So no matter what platform you're targeting, you're going to be able to benefit from this. So on the topic of audio, there's some other really cool stuff I want to talk about. So our embedded team over the summer has been busy building some high-performance audio DSP blocks. So these not only work faster on device, but they actually perform better when hooked up with a neural network. They're better at extracting features. In this quarter, we're going to be upgrading our post-processing capabilities so that we can make use of the stuff I discussed in the previous slide. And something else that's really exciting is we've been collaborating with Professor Vijay Reddy's team at Harvard University on bringing a few-shot multilingual keyword spotting model to Edge Impulse. So what that means is instead of bringing 10,000 examples of someone saying a keyword, you can bring 5 or 10 and have the equivalent performance. So that's going to be game-changing for people who are prototyping and building production keyword spotting models. We're really excited about that. So a really important part of what makes Edge Impulse so special is that it allows developers to deploy machine learning anywhere they want with confidence. And as we've seen, there's this incredible diversity in embedded machine learning that means that you can basically find the exact correct device for your particular constraints in your application. And we're seeing that more and more devices are becoming more and more capable of running bigger and better workloads. But we're, you know, I feel like we do a pretty good job of this, but we're not satisfied to be just in the present moment. We always want to be looking to the future. And so that's why we're really excited to announce that we're partnering with Aleph Semiconductor to provide support for the first commercial Cortex M55 plus Ethos U55 chip. So this is an accelerator technology from ARM that can give you a 480 times performance increase for ML workloads. So this is game changing for the type of workload that we can run on low power devices. Think multiple vision models running concurrently, object detection on multiple streams of images, all on the same low-power device. Really, really excited. But I don't want to leave you with that. There's one more thing, courtesy of our CTO, Jan, who couldn't make it today. But this is something I'm really excited about, because earlier this year, we launched object detection within Edge Impulse. And our initial release was targeted at embedded Linux, because object detection models in the current state-of-the-art form are pretty big and unwieldy. They involve a lot of post-processing, which is kind of difficult to do, and they're not a very good fit for embedded. They actually don't even work that well in a lot of the kind of challenges that embedded devices face when you're trying to look at very small objects or large numbers of objects in the same frame. So I'm really excited to announce that we've actually gone back to the drawing board and reimagined object detection for embedded, and created object detection models that will even run on an MCU. So I have a little video so that I can show you. So this is a demo we can actually see outside on the floor today. And we have a conveyor belt here that is moving past these cubes. And this model that's working on a 96 by 96 grayscale input is able to recognize objects with around 11 frames per second on a 400 megahertz DSP. So this is really game-changing. This unlocks our whole developer community of thousands and thousands of people to perform object detection and localization on microcontrollers. On microcontrollers, it's going to be still, you know, a fairly low frames per second thing. But if you have a DSP, you can get real-time, very nice performance. And if you're running on embedded Linux, this can be astonishingly fast. Also, this algorithm is better at detecting smaller and more numerous objects, which is incredibly important in a lot of industrial and commercial applications, things like people counting, for example. And even more, the model is capable of pixel-level segmentation, so we can really help you understand what's going on in a given image. Incredibly excited to make this available to you all later this year. So I just wanted to say thank you to everybody who's here and everybody who's watching. This community of the people working in the embedded ML space, from researchers through to the companies that are building silicon, through to the companies that are building software and products, and our community of hackers and makers who are also using our technology, is just a massive inspiration every day. And I'm really looking forward to see the incredible stuff that all of you produce with the things that we're releasing at this event. Thank you very much.